Hi everyone. In this video, I am continuing with the topic, that is objective concepts of synopsis of organic chemistry. Okay. In that, the another topic is qualitative analysis of organic compounds. Here, first you should know why we have to study about this topic. Now, the chapter is about organic compound. The compound which is containing carbon and hydrogen are considered as organic compound. Whatever the elements present in that compound, that we want to know first. Okay, it may be qualitatively or quantitatively. So in qualitative methods, okay, qualitative method, we will come to know whether such type of elements present in the compound or not. Okay, just the presence of elements in an organic compound can be known by using qualitative analysis. But the amount of such elements in that organic compound can be found by using quantitative analysis. Okay, quantitative analysis will give the amount of the element. But qualitative analysis can explain only whether the element is present or not. Presence only can be known by using this qualitative analysis. Okay, now we'll see different types of techniques what we are using to know the presence of different elements. Organic compounds means not only carbon and hydrogen, along with carbon and hydrogen, other elements are also present. Okay, along with carbon and hydrogen, even other elements are also present. Now we want to identify presence of carbon, hydrogen as well as other elements. First we'll see the method to find or detect the presence of carbon and hydrogen. Okay, so first one, detection of carbon and hydrogen. To detect this carbon and hydrogen, first carbon and hydrogen are detected by heating the compound with copper oxide. Some organic compound is given, for example, that organic compound is now heating with copper oxide. Okay, whenever it is heated with the copper oxide, this organic compound is now containing carbon and hydrogen, right? Organic compound containing carbon and hydrogen is heated with copper oxide. Understand? Carbon present in the compound changes to carbon dioxide. Okay? And hydrogen present in the compound, so that hydrogen can be converted into water. Okay, so hydrogen present in the compound can be converted into water. So by this manner, hydrogen is converted into water. By this method, we can confirm the presence of carbon and hydrogen. So for that purpose, first we have to do a test. Okay, now we'll see the reactions. Whenever you heat organic compound containing carbon and hydrogen with copper oxide, this carbon reacts with copper oxide, CuO. Okay, 2 moles of copper oxide will be required. 2 oxygens are present, right? These 2 oxygens react with carbon, converts into carbon dioxide, plus releases copper metal. Understand? Now, hydrogen is also present in the organic compound. This hydrogen also reacts with copper oxide. Okay, hydrogen present in the organic compound, when heated with copper oxide, it reacts with copper oxide. Take here 2 moles of hydrogen to balance the reaction. When 2 hydrogens takes oxygen, converts into H2O, plus it releases copper metal. Okay, now we want to know whether CO2 is released, H2O is released in the compound or not. So that whatever the carbon dioxide is released in the compound, for example, I am taking here a test tube. Okay, into this test tube we have taken now hydrocarbon, that is organic compound, and to that what we have added, copper oxide. Okay, I am taking like this. Whenever it is heated, okay, carbon present here combined with copper oxide releasing CO2 gas, and hydrogen present in the test tube reacts with copper oxide releasing H2O. Water in the form of water vapor, carbon dioxide in the form of gas is released. Both are in gaseous state and it is colorless. We cannot find easily whether that gas is released or not. Even in our surroundings, carbon dioxide is present, but we cannot find that carbon dioxide because it is colorless, odorless. Understand? Now, whatever the carbon dioxide is releasing, that is passing through another test tube. Okay, carbon dioxide whatever is releasing, that is passing through the another test tube containing calcium hydroxide, which is nothing but lime water. Okay, this is lime water. Okay, this is known as lime water. So usually lime water is cream in color. Whenever this lime water turns milky, so that indicates CO2 is released in the test tube. Okay, whenever lime water turns to milky, that confirms that CO2 is released. How this cream color lime water turns to milky, that we'll see. Whatever carbon dioxide is released, now reacting with lime water. Lime water formula, CaOH taken twice. This is known as lime water. Okay, when carbon dioxide released, react with lime water, that is calcium hydroxide. Calcium and CO2 take this oxygen, converts into CaCO3, calcium carbonate. So that means calcium hydroxide turns to calcium carbonate. That's why the total test tube turns to milky, plus two hydrogens and one oxygen react together, eliminates as H2O. Understand? So this is, in this way we can confirm carbon dioxide is released. So that released carbon dioxide confirms the organic compound is containing carbon atom. In the same manner, whatever H2O is released, okay, by the presence of hydrogen, that 5 moles of H2O reacts with copper sulfate, CuSO4. This is color, white in color. Usually copper sulfate is white in color. Here there is no water molecule. Whenever it reacts with water molecule, it converts into CuSO4.5H2O. CuSO4.5H2O, which is known as, which is in blue color. Okay, this is in blue color. So this confirms, so whenever the white color copper sulfate turns to blue color, that indicates that water is reacted with copper sulfate. This water came from what? It is from the hydrogen atom. The released water molecule indicates the presence of hydrogen. So by this method we can confirm the organic compound containing carbon and hydrogen. Understand? So that is the detection of carbon and hydrogen. Now we'll see detection of other elements. Now we'll see the second method, that is detection of other elements. I already told you, in organic compound other than carbon and hydrogen, few other elements are also present, like nitrogen, sulfur, halogen and phosphorus. Like nitrogen, sulfur, halogen and phosphorus. If these elements are present, they can be detected by using Lesine's test. First, we'll see how to perform this Lesine's test. To identify the presence of these elements, first these elements should be treated with sodium. When sodium reacts with carbon and nitrogen present in the compound, it can be converted. It is on heating, it can be converted into sodium cyanide, NaCN. Okay, the same sodium when it is react with sulfur, okay, it converts into Na2S. That means to balance the reaction, here you have to take two sodium. Sodium sulfide is created. In the same manner, when sodium reacts with halogen on heating, okay, it converts into sodium halide. So here these are said to be nitrogen, carbon, sulfur, halogen are forming the organic compound. Cyanide, sulfide, halide of sodium. Cyanide, sulfide, halide of sodium is known as, which is boiled. Okay, after getting this, whenever it is boiled, whatever the extract is obtained, that extract is known as sodium fusion extract. Okay, on boiling, whatever is obtained, that is known as sodium fusion extract. Okay, now this sodium fusion extract is used to identify the elements individually. So first we'll see test for nitrogen. Test for nitrogen. First we have to take this sodium fusion extract. Okay, it is boiled with iron sulfate. Sodium fusion extract, whenever it is boiled with iron sulfate or ferrous sulfate, okay, again it will give some X compound. Now this X compound is acidified with sulfuric acid. Okay, it leads to give okay, on heating or acidifying with sulfuric acid, it can give Persian blue color. Persian blue color. So this Persian blue color indicates the presence of nitrogen present in the organic compound. Understand? So to perform this nitrogen test, first we have to take sodium fusion extract. That sodium fusion extract is now containing cyanide, where nitrogen is present in the form of cyanide, Cn. So I am taking only cyanide, Cn minus, from sodium fusion extract. Now it is reacting with what? Iron sulfate. Especially it reacts with iron of iron sulfate. Okay, to balance the reaction, take here 6 moles of cyanide. When 6 moles of cyanide of sodium fusion extract react with iron of iron sulfate, it converts into hexacyanoiron. It converts into hexacyanoiron. That is FeCn taken 6 minus 4 complex. This complex will be obtained. Now, this complex reacts with iron of iron sulfate once again, okay, converts into another compound. So FeCn taken 6. So this complex, now I am taking in 3 moles. When 3 moles of this reacts with 4Fe plus 3 iron, okay, it converts into FeCn taken 6 in 3 moles. Okay, because here we have taken 3 moles, here we have to write taken thrice. Okay, plus it releases XH2O, because the total reaction takes place in presence of water, so it releases XH2O. Whatever ferric ferrocyanide is formed, this is called ferric ferrocyanide. This is in Persian blue color. Okay, the formation. So this total is taking place in a test tube. Understand? Whenever the test tube solution turns to Persian blue color, that confirms the presence of nitrogen present in the organic compound. So this is the test for nitrogen by using sodium fusion extract. Now the second test is test for sulfur. Okay, in the sodium fusion extract even we have sulfur. When the sodium fusion extract, okay, sodium fusion extract is acidified with acetic acid, okay, it can give some X compound whenever it is treated with lead acetate. So it leads to give a black color precipitate. So this black color precipitate confirms the presence of sulfur present in the compound. Otherwise we have one more test. Okay, first we'll see this test. Now sodium fusion extract, is it containing sulfur in the form of sulfide? Yes, minus 2. The sulfide now react with lead of lead acetate, that is Pb plus 2. It converts into PbS. So this BbS is in black color precipitate. So this PbS lead sulfide is in black color. So this black color precipitate confirms the presence of sulfur. So to identify the sulfur, we have one more technique, that is unheating sodium fusion extract. This is first one. Now second one, when sodium fusion extract is treated with sodium nitroprusside. Okay, it appears a violet color. So this violet color indicates the presence of sulfur in the given organic compound. Even by using this technique, we can easily identify the presence of sulfur. Now I am taking sulfide of sodium fusion extract. When it react with sodium nitroprusside, only nitroprusside I am taking, that is FeCn taken 5NO, which is in minus 2. Okay. So this is nitroprusside. So this nitroprusside react with this, okay, converts into FeCn taken 5NOS. Okay, sulfur is entered into the complex and charge is changes to minus 4. So this complex is in violet color. Okay, this violet color complex is obtained due to the presence of sulfur in the compound. So even by using this technique, we can easily identify the presence of sulfur in the given organic compound. In case, okay, this is only about the sulfur. In case both carbon and sulfur is present in the organic compound, okay, whenever it is treated with the compound, so it leads to give sodium thiocyanate. For example, now I am taking sodium in sodium fusion extract. Now it is containing carbon, nitrogen as well as sulfur. Okay, organic compound is containing carbon, nitrogen and sulfur. When it is heated with the sodium, converts into sodium thiocyanate, NaSCl. This is called sodium thiocyanate. This sodium thiocyanate, okay, when it reacts, it gives a blood red color. Okay, that blood red color indicates the presence of cyanides in the compound. Now iron is reacting with this thiocyanate, only this part I am taking in sodium fusion extract. When it react with iron, it converts into SCN. Okay, now this complex is in plus 2 oxidation state. Understand? So due to formation of this complex, the total solution changes to red color. So this red color, blood red color, indicates the presence of both nitrogen, carbon and sulfur in the given organic compound. Now test for halogens. Sometimes organic compound may also contains halogens. Halogens are generally indicated by X. Okay, so such type of halogens. Halogens here are nothing but chlorine, bromine and iodide. Okay, these are known as halides or halogens. The presence of these halogens in the organic compound can be detected by using this technique. Okay, our test. See, now these sodium halides are present in the sodium fusion extract. See here, it is in the form of X. When the sodium fusion extract is treated with silver nitrate, it can give three types of precipitates. It may give white color precipitate, or it may give yellowish precipitate, or it may give completely yellow color precipitate. So three, either of the one can be obtained whenever sodium fusion extract containing halogen react with silver nitrate. Okay, so this yellow color precipitate, now these three precipitates are treated with ammonium hydroxide, NH4OH. Okay, so if suppose whatever white color precipitate is obtained, okay, this white color precipitate easily soluble in ammonium hydroxide. It is soluble in ammonium hydroxide. Indicates the presence of chloride ion Cl-. Understand? Yellowish precipitate, whatever is obtained, whenever it is treated with ammonium hydroxide, it is partially soluble. Means only little soluble, not completely. So this indicates the presence of bromide ion. Okay, or bromine. Okay, sometimes when sodium fusion extract react with silver nitrate, it can give a yellowish precipitate. So yellow color precipitate. Now this yellow color precipitate is treating with ammonium hydroxide, which is completely insoluble. Not even a small compound is soluble in this. This confirms the presence of iodine in the given organic compound. That means the presence of these three atoms or elements in the organic compound can be identified by using this test. Okay, reaction with silver nitrate. So when silver nitrate react with sodium fusion extract containing halogens, it may give white color precipitate, yellowish precipitate or yellow color precipitate. Whatever white color precipitate is obtained when it is treated with ammonium hydroxide, if it is completely soluble, that indicates the presence of chloride or chlorine. Okay, the yellowish precipitate, whatever is obtained whenever it is treated with ammonium hydroxide, if it is partially soluble, then that indicates the presence of bromate. In the same manner, when yellow color precipitate is obtained, if it is treated with ammonium hydroxide, it is insoluble. Not even a small part is soluble. Okay, completely insoluble. That indicates the presence of iodine in the given organic compound. Okay, now finally we'll see the next test. Now we'll see the last qualitative analysis, that is test for phosphorus. Even sometimes organic compounds may also contain phosphorus. Now we want to identify the presence of such phosphorus atom. For that purpose, we are heating your organic compound containing phosphorus with oxidizing agent such as hydrogen peroxide. When organic compound containing phosphorus is treated with hydrogen peroxide, the phosphorus is oxidized to phosphate first. Okay, phosphorus is oxidized to phosphate. Again, it is diluted with nitric acid and treated with ammonium molybdate. It turns to yellow color precipitate. Okay, this yellow color precipitate indicates the presence of phosphorus. Now, I am taking the phosphate obtained here. That phosphate obtained here is sodium phosphate, Na3PO4. Now, the sodium phosphate is diluted with nitric acid, taking here 3 moles of HNO3. It converts into phosphoric acid, that is H3PO4 first on dilution, okay, and converts into sodium nitrate, 3 moles of NaNO3. Here 3 sodiums are there, 3 nitrates are there, they together eliminates as 3 moles of NaNO3, where 3 hydrogens are added to phosphate converts to H3PO4. Understand? Now, whatever H3PO4 is formed here, that participates in this reaction. H3PO4 now reacts with ammonium molybdate, NH4 taken twice MOO4. This is ammonium molybdate. I am taking here 12 moles of ammonium molybdate, and the total reaction is taking place 21 moles of HNO3. When all these react with together, okay, so ammonium molybdate converts to ammonium phosphate molybdate. So PO4 reacts with this ammonium, 3 moles. Totally 24 moles are there. Among the 24 moles, only 3 moles of ammonium reacts with phosphate. NH4 taken thrice PO4 plus dot 12 moles of MOO4 reacted. 12 moles were there, all are reacted here. Plus, still among 24 moles, only 3 are reacted here. Still 21 are there. Such 21 ammoniums reacts with 21 nitrates. Nitrates 21 are there, converts to 21 moles of ammonium nitrate, NH4NO3. Plus 21 hydrogens takes your oxygens, converts into 12 moles of H2O. Okay, so finally we got here what? Ammonium phosphomolybdate. This is called ammonium phosphomolybdate. So this ammonium phosphomolybdate is yellow in color. So this confirms the presence of phosphorus. So by this methods we can easily identify the presence of or confirm the presence of phosphorus atom. So this is about the qualitative analysis of or analysis to detect the presence of carbon, nitrogen, halogen, sulfur and phosphorus. Okay, so that is about this, and based on this bits related to the concepts we'll see in the next one, next class. Thank you.